The world we live in feels normal, ordinary. It feels like this is just how humans exist and always existed.
If it feels normal to you, you're probably not looking deeply enough into things, because almost everything is interesting and magical and crazy if you look into it deeply enough.
But it's not. Never before have we humans lived in a world as sophisticated and engineered to our needs as today, giving us the luxury to forget about ourselves and not worry about survival.
So true.
Food, shelter, security, all of this is more or less taken for granted. But we're a special few. For more than 99.99% of human history, life
was... I often wonder if that's why we have so many problems with all this mental health stuff, because life is so cushy. You know, we can just sit around and be comfortable. And not many people seem to want to do stuff and just enjoy things. And that's good. But some people, for some reason, can't sit around and do things. And when they do that, they feel terrible. Who knows what's, you know, going on with the mental health in terms of how it relates to this. But, you know, like, imagine people in times of war and before that, when they're hunting for their food. You know, if you're sad and stuff, you're obviously just going to... That's you done. You know, you're not going to get food. So maybe in the past, it was selected. Natural selection was selecting for people who, just did things. And so now we're allowing everyone to survive. Not allowing. It's not like anyone's allowing. Or nature. That could be why. You know, everyone's just allowed to, if they don't want to sort of work hard or try and do things. It sounds kind of cruel. I'm just trying to, like, give you some, like, from previously in history, where was all the mental health problems, you know? It's very interesting to think about. And I don't think we think about this enough, because if we did, maybe there's things we could do to try and simulate, I don't know. It's not like we can force people to go live like they used to. It was a terrible time. I'm just thinking.
It's completely different. And there's no such thing as just one human history. Our story begins 6 million years ago, when the tribe of Hominini split and our relationship with the apes ended. 2.8 million years ago, the genus of Homo, the first humans, emerged. We like to think of ourselves as the only humans, but this is far from the truth. When we, Homo sapiens sapiens, came into existence 200,000 years ago, there were at least 6 other human species around. Cousins of comparable intelligence and ability, which must have been incredibly scary, kind of like living with aliens. Some of them were very successful. Homo erectus, for example, survived for 2 million years, 10 times longer than modern humans have existed. The last of the other humans disappeared around 10,000 years ago. We don't know what caused them to die out. Modern humans have at least a few percent of Neanderthal and other human DNA, so there was some mixing, but certainly not enough to be a merger between species. So we don't know if our cousins went away because they lost the battle over resources or because of a series of minor genocides. Either way, only we remain. Back to
also
the
beginning. Also could be natural phenomena like ice ages and things, and we just got lucky.
Things of humanity. 2.8 million years ago, early humans used tools, but did not make a lot of progress for nearly 2 million years, until they learned to control fire. Fire meant cooking, which made food more nutritious, which contributed to the development of our brain. It also produced light and warmth, which made days longer and winters less gruesome. On top of that, it not only scared predators away, it could also be used for hunting. A torched wood or grassland provided small animals, nuts and tubers, that were pre-roasted. From 300,000 years ago, most of the different human species lived in small hunter-gatherer societies. They had fire, wood and stone tools, planned for the future, buried their dead, and had cultures of their own. But most importantly, they spoke to each other, probably in a kind of proto-language less complex than ours.
That's an interesting thing to think about, because, like, language is kind of how we decipher thoughts. Or it's incredible to really think about this, you know, before language, what were they thinking about? What do animals think about? And you can kind of touch on this maybe with thinking about, you know, aphantasia, and how some people can't actually have an inner monologue, and some people can't visualize things in their head. So there are other ways of going about things, but before language, it's like, well, how did they even express all this different stuff? They probably didn't. Probably just felt. Very true, Andira. Up here, community was basically mandatory. Yeah. You were screwed if you were a loner back then, introverts. So maybe there's something wrong with all the introverts alive today. We're all the, you know, the mutated ones. I like to think about that. And but I also, wishful thinking, like to imagine that, you know, maybe us introverts are the ancestors of the astronomers and people who maybe had to stay up at night to look at the stars to be able to tell when to plant things or do things like that. God loves beetles. Yeah, they're the most common species on the planet. Like one in three species around is a beetle. Planet of the Beetles.
If we had a time machine, how far would we be able to go?
Back to the Future 3, when he goes to the Indians. So good.
Back, steal a few babies, and raise them today without anyone noticing that they're a bit different. There is much debate. Anatomically,
there's some science coming out recently about this, whether or not brains have changed over like the last 30,000 years, and they currently actually don't think they've really changed. But surely something changed, because we only started painting on caves like 42,000 years ago in a cave like in Indonesia. So it's like, what happened there? And then language is only like 6,000 years old or something. So it's like, what caused the spur changes in these times?
Debate. Anatomically, modern humans emerged 200,000 years ago, but probably 70,000 years is as far as we could travel back. And
I disagree. We have evidence in Australia for Aborigines existing beyond 70,000 years. I think it's like 80,000 years. And so I think there's even some tools to suspect it might be like 120,000 years Aborigines. And I think this has been pushed back to maybe about 300,000 years. And I saw some recent studies finding some tools that we think were used by, you know, humans about 500,000 years, because they were like axes and things. But the last bit could be mistaken. That was a while ago that I read that. Anyway, things to keep in mind. Do your own research. This is not the area I look into, just curious and like reading. You should come check out KelVPN, post-quantum VPN I've created. You can get a free little trial. Come check it out. It's got the best encryption on the internet. It can literally protect you from quantum computers.
To still snatch a behaviorally modern human. Before that, the babies would probably lack a few crucial gene mutations necessary to build a brain with modern language and abstract thinking abilities.
It's so interesting to think about.
Point around 50,000 years ago, there was an explosion in innovation. Tools and weapons became more sophisticated.
I don't know, because if you think about just natural selection defining evolution, you know, there has to be evolutionary pressures, right? So it's like, you know, and all changes are mutations. And so every species, every, you know, baby is actually the same species as its parent, technically, which is hard to think about. And then imagine how we've changed so much from fish. And so so mutations, right? Random mutations in your DNA, but there might be other mechanisms. Like some people have put forward geneticist ideas of like molecules, the structure and shape being passed on. But anyway, so passing on genetics, so mutation, if that's the only way, well, then there must have been random mutations in maybe the brain and different areas of the brain for these babies and things that might have allowed them to do things that increase their survivability, which I imagine, you know, if you're able to like be more coordinated, if you're able to remember, if you're able to speak or guide the others in your tribe, your survivability goes up. So I imagine, like he suggested, these things would have accumulated over time, and that tribe, whoever had, you know, that baby with the mutation, which it, you know, passed on to its offspring. This is all me just speculating, right? This is, you don't take my word for this stuff, you know, just fun to do this, entertainment.
Because at this point, humans had a multi-purpose brain and a more advanced language to communicate information with each other effectively and down to the last detail. This allowed much closer cooperation and is what really makes us different from any other creature on Earth. Not our comparatively weak bodies and inferior senses, but the ability
there's lots
to
of animals
flexibly in large groups.
There's lots of animals,
for
that
example,
do this.
Rigid beehives or intimate but tiny wolf packs. As our brain evolved,
don't they do fairly similar things? Like bees have a language and very complex languages, and wolves can communicate. I might have missed the specific word he used.
We became able to do something life had been unable to do up to this point. One, expand knowledge quickly. Two, preserve the knowledge gained over generations. Three, build on past knowledge to gain even deeper insights. This seems daft, but until then, information had to be passed on from generation to generation, mostly through genetics, which is not efficient. Still, for the next 40,000 years...
Yeah, that's true. You're passing on information through stories and through memory. Wow, that is clearly a great benefit to have, rather than just relying on slow evolution through genetics. You can just pass on the stories. And so obviously when we started telling stories, that must have been a bit where we kind of exploded, surely, in our development, and painting and art, and then obviously writing even more so, more recently.
Human life remained more or less the same. There was little to build upon. Our ancestors were only one animal among many. Building a skyscraper without knowing what a house is hard. But while it's easy to be arrogant in our attitude to our ancestors, this would be ignorant. Humans 50,000 years ago were survival specialists.
Is that Rambo?
They had a detailed mental map of their territory, their senses were fine-tuned to the environment, they knew and memorized a great amount of information about plants and animals. They could make complicated tools that required years of careful training and
very... They were definitely probably fitter than you.
...very fine motor skills. Their bodies compared to our athletes today, just because of their daily routines, and they lived a rich social life within their tribe.
I imagine people were more like Rambo back in those times.
Survival required so many skills that the average brain volume of early modern humans might even have been bigger than it is today. As a group, we know more today, but as individuals, our ancestors were superior to us. But then, around 12,000 years ago, in multiple locations, humans developed agriculture. Everything changed very quickly. Before, survival as a hunter and forager...
But why did agriculture develop? Probably from the ability to share stories and failures and writing. You know, you can write down what worked, you do this over a few generations, and wow, you've got so much knowledge just by trial and error now. You know, it's, in a way, science, the scientific method. Really cool to think about.
Required superb physical and mental abilities in all fields from everybody. With the rise of the agricultural age, individuals could increasingly rely on the skills of others for survival. This meant that some of them could specialize. Maybe they worked on better tools. Maybe they took time to breed more resistant crops or better livestock. Maybe they started inventing things. As farming got more and more efficient, what we call civilization began. Agriculture gave us a reliable and predictable food source, which allowed humans to hoard food on a large scale for the first time, which is much easier to do with grains than meat. A food stock required protection, which led to communities living together in tighter spaces. First, early defense structures were built. The need for organization grew. The more organized we got, the faster things became efficient. Villages became cities. Cities became kingdoms. Kingdoms became empires. Connections between humans exploded.
It's amazing to realize there's been, what, like 117 billion humans to ever live, and roughly half of them existed about before this time. Isn't that crazy? All of those humans before, you know, Jesus, well before that, actually. So it's like, wow, what were all those humans doing? They were doing something similar to us, but what a different life they lived.
Which led to opportunities to exchange knowledge. Progress became exponential. About 500 years ago, the scientific revolution began. Mathematics, physics, astronomy, biology, and chemistry transformed everything we thought we knew.
Did he say 500? Yeah, about 500, but really it was about 2,000 years ago. But unfortunately, we destroyed all of that knowledge and destroyed the Library of Alexandria, where science was kind of born, but fizzled out momentarily. Because of some shitty politics. And some people speculate we might be going to the stars right now if that hadn't have happened, where science was essentially born. We lost a lot of that science as well to just history. Like, there's only a couple scrolls left, and they're quite amazing from that library. So, and there was meant to be many, many, many that we speculate we lost. So it's very interesting.
The Industrial Revolution followed soon after, laying the foundation for the modern world.
You guys know all about from here on.
Grew exponentially, more people could spend their lifetime contributing to the progress of humanity.
I do know about Tycho Brahe and his relation to
its evolution Kepler, into a right? medium we all use on a daily basis, and the rise of the internet shaped our world. It's hard to grasp how fast all of that happened. It's been about 125,000 generations since the emergence of the first human species. About 7,500 generations since the physiologically modern human saw the light of day. 500 generations ago, what we call civilization began. 20 generations ago, we learned how to do science. And the internet became available to most people only one generation ago. Today, we live in the most prosperous age humanity has ever experienced. We have transformed this planet, from the composition of its atmosphere to large-scale changes in its landscape, and also in terms of the other animals in existence. We light up the night with artificial stars and put people in a metal box in the sky. Some have even walked on our moon. We put robots on other planets.
It's all happened very, very recently. It's crazy.
Deep into the past of the universe with mechanical eyes. Our knowledge and our way of acquiring and storing more of it has exploded.
I think it's important to point out our universe has literally grown massively in terms of like how big we thought this place was.
Which high school student today knows
the complexity of the world as well.
More about the universe than a scholar a few centuries ago. Humans dominate this planet, even if our rule is very fragile. We are still not that different from our ancestors 70,000 years ago, but your lifestyle has existed for less than 0.001% of human history. From here on, there's no saying what the future holds for us. We're building a skyscraper, but we're not sure if it's standing on a solid foundation or if we're building it on quicksand. Let's leave it with that for now. The next time you miss your train, your burger is not hot enough, or someone cuts in line, remember how special this made-up human world
is. It's like we're building these skyscrapers of knowledge on top of some structure that might be there underneath. Although Gödel's theorem kind of throws some shade at that. Let's ignore that. Under this maybe, you know, fundamental objective structure, and you know, our structure, though, is flimsy, and it kind of moves, you know, with revolutions of knowledge. And it's fun to think about. And it's like there's other mountains or skyscrapers of knowledge, and they're all interconnected. And so you shift one, they all kind of shift. Some are larger than others, and it's crazy. And it seems like there's some kind of mysterious structure underneath. But, you know, if you know anything about Gödel's theorem, it might be truth that transcends logic, unfortunately.
It is. Maybe it's not worth being upset about all those little things. Okay, this was our first take on.
Yep, it's like Carl Sagan says, in a roughly 100 billion galaxies, about 2 trillion now, you'll not find another human being. So, you know, if they do something wrong, if they get upset with you, let them live, especially if you don't agree with them. So, anyway, my friends, that is the end of today's stream.